remote college to allow him to join in the live events. And I hope you'll pardon me while I just let him know about this latest one. And there we'll go ahead. Okay, great. Okay, so I'm interested in making sure that we have as much time as possible for the projects today to help push them forward, put us in a good position for getting them to a good milestone by tomorrow. So within this talk, I'm going to be discussing aspects of study planning and project recruitment and offering some comments on the issue of compensation and incentives. Incentives for individuals for involvement in the project to the degree that REBs are comfortable with that notion. Okay? And I'm going to begin as well local recording for this. Okay. Great. Okay. So as for the last lecture, I'm going to keep my comments because I would like to keep this discussion brief, and I would like to make sure that where we do spend time, it's for key issues and issues where you might have questions. To address that need, before I dive into this topic, I first want to engage this dialogue specifically around the issue of human ethics and any concerns with respect to REBs, institutional review boards, and the ethics of collection of this high velocity, high volume, high variety, and high veracity. Are there any aspects of the ethical context that you folks would like to address? For example, I didn't go into physiological data specifically. I didn't talk about the particular challenges associated with studies that involve an intervention. For example, our predecessors have been part of. So any questions you would like to discuss on the ethical front? Yes, Erica. I am so grateful for this question, and I stand before you negligent, inconsiderate for not having brought that out in my previous slides. I'm not sure, because I know I have slides about that, and maybe they're in this next deck rather than the earlier one. But I'll make some comments on that. There are, as everyone in the room will appreciate, there are unique features associated with conducting studies based on the characteristics of the participants. Whether it's older individuals with dementia, small children, teenagers and adolescents, or young adults, there's very different needs and vulnerabilities associated with different groups. And we have conducted now a variety of different studies with younger populations, both in Canada and in Europe, particularly I have in mind Switzerland. I believe that there might have been some in the U.S. that Mohammed is involved in, but I'm less aware of them. So it's been predominantly for me Canadian and European. And within this context, there are variety of special needs that one needs to address. So they include securing informed consent from guardians or parents, and assent for children who are older. Opting out in a way that may override parental permission or consent for involvement, but allowing the older adolescents, for example, adolescents, to say, look, even if my parents gave consent, I don't want to be part of this. I feel that it's intrusive or too prying for me. This is notable because the attitudes of adolescents towards technologies and privacy within my living memory of the past 6 or 7 years has evolved greatly. Actually, probably 10 years, I'd say. There was a time where adolescents seemed to be blithely less concerned about privacy, just saying, well, it's all taken. These days, my observation is many adolescents have a degree of extra sharpness and concern not cynicism, but jadedness, knowing just how much information is being collected, and therefore sometimes opt into systems like Snapchat, which have shorter vaporization of, as it were, of shared content, and which protect them against certain types of privacy risks. I think part of the popularity of WhatsApp has to do with its encryption, and young people have opted into it. So this issue of older children opting out is really important. Naturally, within this context, is a need to provide accessible explanations of study operations, of motivations, of benefits, health insights in terms of benefit to society. There are unique concerns with children, minors, including adolescents, in terms of online behavior and screen time when it comes to giving a phone to it. Like, there are some studies, there are many studies we've conducted in earlier years, predominantly 3 or more years ago, where we gave phones out to individuals because they were expensive enough that we couldn't assume widespread penetration in the studies, in the study population's interest. And among adolescents, there was particularly concern, and among younger children now, there's particular concern, are you skewing their experience and their health habits by giving a phone or by encouraging them to spend more time with the phone, even to just interact with it. It's particularly concerned if you're giving a phone where they didn't have one before. So a child of 10 years old and you're giving a phone. And one of my own perspectives would be try to see what you can do with beacons for kids rather than phones. So again, take advantage of this issue that, we don't always need a phone to indicate a person, to detect other study participants. A beacon, placed on a child's, child's person in their backpack or whatever, might be enough with parental consent. And then we don't involve them with screen time that they otherwise wouldn't have obtained. So particularly for individuals who didn't have phones, for minors who didn't have phones, that's a big concern. My observation is that youth are often much more impatient with technology, expecting it to just work and expecting it to serve their needs. And one of the things Mohammed has taught, this was in the States, that's right, was a willingness to uninstall Ethica. So we had one study which was run, I think, out of Drexel University. And it was, I think, conducted in a school, if I'm not mistaken. I'm not absolutely positive of this. It's possible it was university students, but in any case, it was students. And they installed the app, and no questions were to be asked for the next month or 6 weeks or something like that. And by the time that time elapsed, most of the participants had uninstalled the app. Uninstalled Ethica. And so guess what? The response rate for that next wave of the survey was very, very low. Because they said, what's this app doing on my phone? You know, I've got enough apps. I don't need to turn. By the way, this is one of these reasons why lessening the dependence of Ethica on an app, allowing Ethica to work without an app through a web-based survey as an alternative, particularly together with wearables, is very attractive. Because among youth, the observation is that often there's a certain willingness to uninstall technology they haven't interacted with in a while. So that's something to watch out for with youth. If you haven't asked them a question in the app and they say, what's this? I haven't done anything with that in a long time. I don't do it. It's nothing. And not treating that with a gravity that perhaps it deserves. Many of our studies with youth have been conducted through schools. There's about 1,000 youth throughout Saskatchewan in public, Catholic, and First Nations schools in our north that are using Ethica as part of their school health assessment. Every year they were filling out forms before, and now they are working through Ethica. And there's questions about mental health and substance use in light of cannabis legalization, e-cigarettes, and the meteoric adverse rise of Juul, et cetera. And in the north, in the Northern Lights School District, there's a particularly strong presence. That's being led by my colleague Chilroon Katapali out of Regina, who has a strategic vision I really admire. And he's gone to enormous work to work with schools, to recruit through schools, to bring parents and school administrators on board at great amounts of energy. But now that he's in there, it's something that each year it's a little bit like, it's inspired a little bit like the Compass study being run by Scott Leatherdale out in Ontario and I think now several other provinces, except they don't yet have Ethica. They'd like to opt into Ethica, but it's a little bit further down. They're in some of our papers together. So anyway, schools are a natural nexus for working with students, for achieving parental consent and student assent. Schools often have a strong interest in promoting healthier living among students and knowing about mental health challenges and anxieties, etc., among students. And so we've had a lot of success with them. And in the Swiss study, which Tina, sitting next to me in the corner, with which she has been one of the key people involved. This was a study delivered in Italian for the county of the canton of Ticino, and it was studying. It is studying mobile app use, screen time, and mental health, amongst other outcomes. It's part of a bigger study. They have a study of youth, which involves traditional instruments, and they have, I think, what is it, Tina, for phase one, was it like 100 students? 110 students, and then phase two, another group. They went through ethics for the major study. This is led by Peter Schultz at University of Switzerland, University of Lugano. And then the Ethica component of it. So there was, you know, these basic elements. What we did find is, a lot of information on screen time, app use, et cetera, through that study, and a pretty good involvement of the youth in terms of staying adherent. Was that monetary? Or was that like gift cards? I think it was gift cards as well. And I don't remember the exact nature of the gift card, but my sense was it was some sort of redeemable items they could use for, let's put it this way, not unhealthy things that would be attractive. Seems like that was a quite successful study by and large. It's interesting to hear about the second component, which I think Tina has just finished working with. I will say this, screen time, measuring screen time very well requires going beyond just looking at the nominal data that you saw earlier, like screen turning on, turning off. To take into account the fact that the phone is off sometimes and that the phone, in some cases, particularly if it's collecting a lot of sensor data, is kicked out of memory sometimes and then brought back. And Tina has done a lot of work on that very successfully. Minor involved studies, what else can I say about their involvement? So some work we did with Harvard, which involved the next older age group. I think it started at 17 or so. What we found is that within the context of some of these studies, we found a subset of the minors actually became very, it almost led to advocacy, health advocacy among some of the youth. They got involved in the study heart and soul, and they contributed it and promoted for it, and that was an example I've discussed, Erica, with you, involving mapping out the community, the places where tobacco would be promoted. It became part of their calling almost to try to contribute to the health of their community. And this is something that amongst minors one can get is. A real commitment to taking this study to its natural conclusion, and providing a study which allows that, if possible, that harnesses that energy of youth and that commitment of youth in a pro-social direction. One of these distinctive things, where if you went, for adults who are working long hours and trying to manage families at home or juggling two jobs, you're not going to get often that level of wholesale commitment into the study. So that's an intriguing part of the human computer of working with youth. Beyond the nominal, the things that are clearly involved and required for ethically conducting studies with youth, there's that ability to, I think, tap into the energy and real verve of youth to contribute in the health front. Those are some comments there. I think, when it comes to the particulars of content, one has to be very careful. For example, in the context of mental health concerns, how one, the nature of the phrasing of the questions, the types of content one provides to the youth as far as videos, opportunities to nudge them for the better. I think one's dealing with a group that has some it's probably a good thing to involve someone who's worked a lot with youth as far as you know, other types of health studies to help craft that content so that it's least likely to be upsetting to youth or least likely to turn them off through through, you know, its patronizing sound. So those are some general comments. Apologies for not having deeper comments on that. Mohammed, have there been other studies in the States where you've been involved with youth that you can recall? The Media Ticino study in Lugano, did they hand out homes to youth, or was already on youth own homes? It's their own fund. Yeah. Thank you very much. I actually have a bunch of slides that I hid because I thought I'm not sure anyone's going to be interested. So I'd be delighted to talk about that. That's awesome. That's awesome. So are there, before I get to that, because that gets into this recruiting and retention and so on, are there any other questions or discussions that folks would like to bring up right now on the ethics? Indeed. Right. Yeah, so this is the AMT reference here. So we have been involved with studies that have had remote recruitment. My recollection of an Alberta Health Service health study was that, so this is by the health service delivery arm of Alberta, not to be distinguished, not to be confused with the Ministry of Health. There's kind of ministerial jurisdiction, and then there's health service, you know, health care delivery systems in Canada that are province-wide and are the purview of each province. And Alberta Health Services did an early study with Ethica. And Mohammed, can you help me remember, there was a video made for consent, I thought, in that context. I'm trying to remember. There was certainly a video. I remember you creating it and so on. Was that used for the consent process, or was that in-person consent and the video was for extra information? Facebook-based recruiting. Yeah, and was there a video involved? part of what was going on there was to help provide that information before getting the app, with the recognition that people are less likely to download the app without having a great deal of confidence about the study. And you know, downloading the app is a major step towards participating, so we didn't want to just put that information into Ethica. You know, you had to have Ethica app in order to read all about Ethica, or sorry, read all about the study. We wanted that information to be available before and have a video. But Ethica itself supports rich multimedia content, including in the sort of consent component of Ethica. You may remember that study description. And it can provide a link to the same video. It's just you can't rely on them having the Ethica app. Now, that study also, Mohammed, if I'm not mistaken, when they clicked on the website, there was a link in the website that they would click on. It would download the app and basically request and basically say, so they click on that link. The link was like, you know, join study or something. It would download the app, and through that link also put them in to call up the app for that study. Actually, they had a custom app. They had a custom branded app with Alberta Health Services logo on it and so on. And it would load that up. And by the same token, as Mohammed showed you yesterday, you can have a link which when you click on it, downloads the app and sort of has you go say, I want to join this study, and then you go through the process of saying, do I really want to join it based on the consent form in the app. So there is that option of it's sort of in one fell swoop downloading and saying, I want to join, to the point where you then read the consent form and decide, do I really want to join? But they had this website that was more extensive, included a video before doing that. So thank you, Mohammed, for refreshing our memory. I think that's something that Charles also interested. So recruitment schemes remotely are definitely possible. We've engaged in a variety of recruitment mechanisms, from you know posters around town, emails, social media. So Facebook and Google each allow ads that are quite targeted by demographics and interests and characteristics of individuals, including things like the occupations, for that matter, and often very effective, very effective, cost-effective advertising can be done via Facebook and Google. Basically, they can provide these contextual ads that will help ensure that you recruit a patient population that is as broad as you're hoping or that's targeting a certain age group, et cetera. So this is a very flexible means that's readily tapped into. It's something Mohammed could talk with you more about than I, but it's something that's very current. There's also community sites like Craigslist that are geographically situated. You know, if you have community organizers like Alberta Health Services did, those can be useful. Sometimes you have institutional networks. So our university, if you're recruiting at the university, we can go through the Social Science Research Lab and the Qualtrics sort of panel they have, or the PAWS site. In other cases, we've engaged in snowball sampling or respondent-driven sampling to get people in networks. So we recruit starting from a seed group, and they provide a link to us, to their friends, through a card or some sort of mechanism so that their friends have the option of opting in. This, again, is something where we're not allowed to get the names of their friends because their friends haven't told us they can. And so they have to tell their friends about us, not tell us about their friends, mm-hmm. for ethics reasons. It was quite successful. But involves a fair bit of work if the study is contingent, for for a given individual on having network contacts that are also in the system. We have considered seriously AMT, Amazon Mechanical Turk. We have recruited people remotely for other studies that we've run in our lab. In fact, we haven't gone through AMT. We've gone through other panel of providers, but have an interest in AMT, but haven't yet taken that step. Others in our department have. There's also a potential for tapping into existing Ethica users by notifying them of new studies, although we haven't tapped that off. That was part of the original vision of Ethica, that someone who may opt into one study may subsequently opt into others. Maybe they're offering the same data to two different studies, and they receive compensation to recognize their contribution in both, but the data is being used for different types of analysis. So one question that used to come up an awful lot with smartphones is, aren't you intervening with something like Ethica? So you have a study in Ethica, which is about a certain topic. You have these questionnaires that are in front of people a lot, involving their physical activity or their nutritional intake, or involving their community level support for physical activity, or involving their use of cigarettes. Aren't you, to some degree, intervening by asking these micro questionnaires multiple times a day or multiple times a week? And the truth is, there is probably some impact on perception. You have these things in front of the people at all times, and it leads to reflection on it sometimes, sometimes it may affect their sense of what important things their decisions are on the health front. Whilst Ethica may aspire to understand health behaviors, exposures, knowledge, attitudes, and beliefs in a way that for a given study doesn't try to affect them, the fact is often it has some effect, likely. How big that effect is, our own anecdotal evidence is that there is a Hawthorne effect, but it probably fades pretty quick for many studies. Okay, we've seen some evidence of earlier change and then a reversion to what seems to be patterns that persist for a longer time. This used to be the case more when we handed out smartphones. We'd hand out a smartphone, and suddenly there's the experience of having a smartphone, and their life starts to change around the smartphone, and that leads them to be very acutely aware for the first week or two, but then it reverts to sort of more typical patterns. These days, with Ethica being an app on their existing phone, I'm especially a little bit skeptical as to just how big the Hawthorne effect is, but we really need to research it more. Cheryl. Yeah. Yeah, I think there was at least, I think, one or two other studies where we deliberately had a kind of, as you said, a burn-in period where we said we'll discard data from the first little bit. And certainly Tina, in some of her analysis work, Tina is like the queen of analysis with Ethica. And she's done a fair bit of work like putting aside data from the first day or something for a study, or our first half day, or what have you. generally it hasn't been as long as a week, but maybe for one or two studies, that rings a bell for some studies in earlier years. I think it's probably a good practice to do that, and probably we need to learn from those experiences. What I'd really like to do is see if we could do any sort of tests that might lend an understanding of how long that period should be and how big the effects are. It probably varies quite a lot by the content of the study, right? But it's, I mean, one of the real advantages of Ethica as a system, and one which we designed it for, was to be able to iterate quickly, you know, roll something out kind of quickly, try it, observe, learn from that, fold it into a more refined study. And I think something like this probably could be done as far as learning how long that initial period should be where you ignore the data. It's something we probably need to do more work on. I don't have anything too deep to say. Mohammed, have you worked with somewhere where the first week has been tossed or something like that? In some studies, like the multi-thousand person study that you're spending a lot of work on now, which is one of several now that Ethica has run that are larger in size, like in the thousands, that study, I think you were saying that it involves some people recruited well before the actual study initiates for them. So, and one other thing I'll just mention along these lines, this probably wasn't what Cheryl had in mind, you know, vis-a-vis Hawthorne effect, but one thing we certainly see, I should really have a slide on this, you know, when you do this sort of work, you need to go through all your normal care with respect to bookkeeping and keeping track of, you know, which participant started when and you know, if you, when engaging with the participants, say for at time of recruitment, did the study organizer walk them through how the surveys are answered? If so, those survey answers are not the participant survey answers. Those are the study organizer's study answers. And that may sound trivial, but I have to tell you that some of the more painful experiences, the most painful studies I've been involved with Ethica, actually your predecessors to Ethica particularly, were studies where some basic paperwork was not done, like about the day that a certain participant started, before the exact procedure used with each participant. And so we didn't know, like, is this question, is this answer to a given survey from the participant and from the organizer showing it to the participant and stuff like that. And this is what Tina has had to deal with in terms of truncating data and trying to sleuth down. They start at, you know, in the morning or the afternoon of that day. Poor Tina has had to go through all sorts of trouble for this. And it matters sometimes because you want to know their baseline situation, and you know, you end up needing to tangle yourself up in knots just because the data wasn't properly recorded about when the survey started. I will mention another thing here with data quality. Let it be a lesson learned. Another thing that we deal with a lot with Ethica to this day, but which Mohammed is leading us to the promised land soon enough, is failing when we are testing a study. Often we will test the study out before deploying it. That's good practice. You want to test it. A better practice is if you could have a duplicate of that study, you test that out, and then you have the real study which you enroll people into. And ne'er the twain shall meet. You know, you don't have, you know, study administrators who are part of the real study and testing it out. But with a lot of studies, we have historically not done that. And we've had study administrators trying out the real study with the conviction that, you know, they want to try out the final draft of things. And then you start recruiting participants, and you have to be super careful to make sure who's a real participant and who's the study organizer, you know. And Tina's had to deal with this a lot, you know, tracking down particularly people whose phones change and stuff. Is that, you know, this study organizer in their old phone, or was this a participant or something like that? And it's for the birds, you know. Mohammed is leading us to a situation where we can designate testers for a study that are clearly designated as being a separate group. So we know when they're in the study, it's in the capacity of testing. They are not participants, and therefore they're ignored from analysis, which is, you know, a much better scheme. But to this point, we've had to do a lot of that manually. And Tina, if Tina has any gray hair on her head, it's probably because of that. Because she's had to sort these things out in ways that no young person should have to go through. And I would venture no middle-aged or even older person should have to go through. In any case, that's a lesson learned, and another reason, in as much as you're just trying to get your eggs and, you know, lined up for launching a study, you probably should give a little bit of time after they get Ethic on their phone, you know, before you start recording data, you know, for real, something along those lines, I'd say. Tina has also done, if anyone's interested, Tina has done better work than anyone else I know on looking at how study adherence changes over time. So this is a big issue, right? If you think study adherence is going to drop quickly after the first day, maybe you want to make, you're engaged in logical brinksmanship. You want to make as best use of that first day as you can, because you're afraid that after that they won't be as adherent. For a number of our studies, Tina has documented very good levels of adherence over many weeks or months, potentially. So Cheryl's study also with foodborne illness was enjoyed many virtues to recommend it. One of them was continued adherence. Probably the best planned study. Cheryl and Harvard study are just up there side by side for just exquisite levels of care and competence and delivery and strength of adherence that was secured. Okay, so I noted smartphone wearable use for data collection as a potential for influence behavior, and data collection mechanisms can leverage intervention effectiveness. We kind of talked about that early on, this duality of interventions and leveraging them with data collection and understanding their effects with data collection. So common stages of the participant experience. You know, for broad studies, participants often go through a set of stages. And probably this doesn't need mentioning, but I'll just emphasize it. You know, someone encounters a promotion, or they learn, they get some awareness of the study, they learn about the study. If motivated, they take an eligibility survey. They undertake an eligibility survey, which might or might not be required. And then they're either meet with a group to get information to provide them with, to walk them through an informed consent process, or they watch a video and read material that provides them with the requisite understanding and maybe tests that understanding with a little questionnaire so that we're sure that they have truly informed consent, not merely nominal consent that they rush through. And at some point, if they feel comfortable with it, they'll offer consent. And then there's a baseline survey. They engage in participation, and they either complete or they drop out, in which case they can be delivered an exit survey. Barriers to recruitment are diverse for different subpopulations. In some populations, there have been cost barriers. We're limited in how many people we can recruit because it's fairly expensive. Some of our early work pre-Ethica involved Mohammed with weight scales. Mohammed did amazing jobs with programming drivers for weight scales, as I recall. It was Wii Fit devices, for any of you who remember what those are. The Wii Balance Board Mohammed used for gathering participants' weights. If you have to hand out wearables, that can be expensive, right? If you have to hand out hex shirts that are several hundred dollars, or E4s that are thousands of dollars, data plans back in the day, working with Erica, handing out data plans. It's not cheap. It's not cheap to get data plans. For low SES populations, access to phones has traditionally been more of a challenge. These days, what we find is a lot of low SES populations have smartphones. They tend to have somewhat older smartphones, but they have smartphones. And studies of some SES populations have emphasized just how important those phones are to their lives, to staying in touch with their social support networks that they depend on so keenly because of their socioeconomic challenges, because of their lifeline to resources and services that they deliver on. So we find a growing set of people in lower SES groups have phones these days. There are exceptions. Individuals who are struggling with drug addiction, living disordered lives, have difficulty keeping phones. From the effects of intoxication, their phones can be easily stolen, they may have trouble, keeping them in working order. Keeping them charged. So that's disordered populations. For complex designs, there can be a time-consuming per participant setup. This was less of a problem. Cheryl's study worked very effectively for a complex design, despite its intricate and exquisite care with which it was designed. By contrast, the Harvard study that I referred to, which was one of two we partnered with Dana-Farber, involved very time-consuming setup because of network-based recruitment. In fact, we couldn't recruit an ego until their alters had committed, et cetera. Another issue is lack of interest or incentive, perceived burden. For some populations, trust is an issue. Lack of awareness, community buy-in, and then lack of comfort with technology. This is a point of discussion with Erica right now. We do live in a world where a growing number of our parents, if we consider those in the room, I recognize that for the youth in the back, their parents may be my junior But for many of us who benefit from the seniority of age, our parents are increasingly, that generation is increasingly open to carrying smartphones. I'm still working my mom and dad, but you know, they're getting closer, right? They're sending the text messages and A. They have to press for to get to the C. It's horrible. And they're getting to a position of being comfortable with smartphones. But there is another level up, like 85-year-olds now, 80-year-olds. It's really hard to get them carrying smartphones. And that probably is a cohort effect. As time goes on, probably 80-year-olds in another 5 years, they may be, you know, carrying around iPhones. I'm not sure. But there is still the older, the high ages of the age spectrum challenge. Of challenging whether the Ethica app is actually a required part of Ethica studies. Because if elderly individuals could instead carry wearables, and there's a growing number of wearables aimed at elderly, including by Aura, Cerise Solanders here in town, these very attractive jewelry-like wearables, if we can capture a growing amount of their sensor data and automatically collect it with wearable and if to the degree they're comfortable, they can use technologies like laptops or desktops that they may have used in their earlier days instead of a smartphone, that provides extra evidence for involvement of this older age cohort. There will be some individuals who don't want to be involved in technology, but for them, carrying jewelry-like wearables may actually provide some ongoing in a way that obviates the need for smartphones. Erica. It's a great question because some of our collaborators in other countries have commented on the challenges associated with working with school boards and boards of education in their context and have lamented how difficult navigating those permission systems is and getting building those relationships. Here in Saskatchewan, we've been very fortunate in that regard, and Tarun has done a great job, but I'm aware of just how impenetrable the prospect can be elsewhere. We have recruited from other venues. For example, YMCAs, YWCAs are another institutional context which has some solidity to it. Where there's group activities and often people leading them who are promoting healthy living and may serve as a point for recruitment. We've had a lot of good luck working in this province as well with YMCA. There's also been some discussion about programs like participation and sort of fitness-oriented programs that are out there, some of which are delivered from schools, and I think some of which are outside. Maybe youth sporting events, I can't speak to, but
getting to those, you're getting to, you know, not as broad brush, broad a set of recruited individuals as from primary schools. So there's some trade-offs there. But I agree with you that in some cases schools are good for a starting point. In other cases, one needs to build relationships for a while before going there and trying out youth recruitment separately. And you know, I've given some ideas there. There's probably many others that that I'm you know, that you might be more aware of, and some brainstorming could reveal as good points. There certainly are a lot of activities these days that are focused outside on encouraging healthy. You know, I wonder about some of the work, for example, in preschool. Another environment, a lot more varied and less highly regimented. For the youngest ages, and it may be there's some, you know, private school activities or activities outside that draw subsets of students like Kumon or others that possibly could be partners for the work. Maybe youth soccer. Just some ideas off the cuff. I will say there's one other group, though, Erica, in talking with you, where I think there's specific needs in terms of barriers to recruitment. And you and I talked and conjectured about how much of the problems, for example, in the PFPD study, how many of the challenges with recruitment we're finding because of the age group, and to what degree we're dealing with individuals who are so overwhelmed by the health issues they're dealing with that. And particularly at the time that we encounter them, like the particular point in their hospital trajectory, that they don't feel empowered or they're not ready in terms of their mind share to opt in. And it may be the same individuals, you know, 2 months hence, in a outpatient or in a context of some sort of other encounter, might be in a position to opt in. It's just following a hospital stay, maybe things are talking early, or think about, you know, modifying their home and getting that home oxygen in place and how they're gonna deal with this issue or that issue with driving. And it may be that it's just too much too soon. So there, it may not be a matter of just, is it the right group or can we get this group? But maybe what's the right, and not just the right location, but the right time. Okay. Time is a fleeting. I mentioned network recruitments. Network recruitment very valuable, but it has its own challenges and sort of ripple through effects. If my ability to be recruited depends on my having altered people in my network who are recruited in sort of an egocentric network context, that complicates the whole decision-making about who's allowed to participate and the effects of opting out on the part of an individual. So we had talked about remote recruitment. In-person recruitment, very valuable for certain needs. We talked yesterday about how certain types of Ethica data sources really are best dealt with by in-person recruitment. Could they be done remotely? They can be, but it leaves open risk of confusion and failing to navigate the needs. An example is, where is the REFOT? There she is. But REFOT is doing, is responsible for a beautiful study. I'd encourage you to look at it, involving individuals in Bangladesh. And she has a Bengali set of contents within Ethica, even though Ethica itself doesn't have a Bengali version, the contents are in Ethica and are in Bengali. recruiting individuals in Bangladesh because she needs to get to sense aptitude. And sensing aptitude involves some additional steps with Ethica to get them to opt in to aptitude. So there's a couple more steps, and rather than trying to do that remotely, she argues that it's better to do it. I tend to agree. Same thing with phone calls and SMS, which you may remember from Mohammed's slides, not 6 hours depth on these very screens involved securing, had several steps. In-person recruitment can also be useful when you give out cards for network-based recruitment to someone you recruit, and you ask them to give those cards, which provide contact information for their friends or contacts to contact us as the survey personnel. In-person recruitment lets you go through a complex consent form, address concerns and confusion involving yourself, to elicit extra information, for example, eligibility criteria, to walk through system functions. I would include here, particularly thinking about the healthcare context, Erica, the capacity to also go through this process with caregivers. And you know, it may be that the person with COPD is actually not the person filling out the reports of exacerbations they caught in recent shortness of breath. Then maybe sometimes it's the caregiver, and by giving that caregiver this, you know, this information, they feel more empowered. I recognize in this case the caregivers are probably themselves a little bit overwhelmed and not ready, but it helps compared to just trying to do something new. You can walk through the system function, show how surveys are answered, etc. Download additional components, provide incentives like gift cards, and if you have to provide phones or smartwatches or weight scales at that point of contact, at time of recruitment. So remote recruitment can offer some real advantages. Recruitment with in-person can offer advantages as well. I would say there's some challenges with remote consent, like verifying age, showing attention, and making sure they really understand that you may want to have a survey to test their understanding following going through that, so you're sure they really understood that. Now, there was a question about phones. I will include, I'm conscious of the time here, I will include some slides about the trade-off of giving out phones. I think I actually put those slides aside. And I will circulate it, Brianna, and then we can talk about it tomorrow in some of the opening discussions. I'd be glad to comment, because we have a lot of experience with giving out phones and the pluses and minuses, gotchas, and some of the real strengths of that approach, which retains its relevance for certain subpopulations, like those who are disordered, individuals who otherwise cannot afford or are not familiar with phones or have too old phones, etc. Okay. If there are any questions, I'm glad to answer them right now. Otherwise, I'd suggest we break into our groups and we can pursue the project. Is that okay? Awesome. Thank you for your patience. And I'm grateful for your time. And we will now initiate the project. Okay, TAs, please commence deployment in support.